Surprise, surprise, it's Anita Raj back today with eCoreAcademy again to give you guys a second video. So today's video, second video, will be on interval notation, the second video for our Algebra 2 course. So interval notation, again, will be the topic we are talking about today. It's going to be our first glimpse into a higher level math. This is a higher level math concept that you learn in Algebra 2 and take with you through pre-calc, calc, and further on. So you guys will definitely benefit from this. I want to ease you guys into the Algebra 2 curriculum that we will be offering at eCoreAcademy. So this is going to be our first step, our baby step towards that. Before I start, I want to ask you guys to like this video and subscribe to our channel for more future content so that you guys can follow along with this Algebra 2 course and also look at the other courses that my brother and I are offering. All right, let's get right into it. So some new vocabulary, there's just one term right here that I want you guys to familiarize yourselves with. It's interval notation, same topic that we are going to be learning all about today. It's used to represent solution sets in higher level math. Think about your inequalities and your compound inequalities that you learned in Algebra 1. Your teacher may have given you an equation, something like 5x plus 15 is greater than 12. I'm just making this up. And then you would solve that inequality to get x is greater than some value. And using that, you would get a number line, and then you would plot the possible values that x would be. You are showing the solution set. What are the possibilities of x? X is not one definite value. It's a possibility in the solution set. You're giving an interval. You're like, this is what x could be. That's what you did with inequalities. We're going to transfer that to interval notation now in Algebra 2, and that is a higher level way of representing these solution sets you guys learned in Algebra 1. All right. So let's get right into interval notation. I'm going to be going through some examples with you. Maybe walking through these examples will help you most benefit in learning this concept and seeing it actually directly applied to problems. So I have six examples of interval notation for you guys. The first three are on this slide. The next three will be on the next slide. So let's run through these three and then those three and see if you guys get a better idea of what interval notation is, if you haven't already heard of it. So let's look at this first section right here. So the first interval I'm given is this, interval between this given point A and given point B. If you see, it's almost like a coordinate pair on a coordinate plane, but here we have brackets. Brackets always represent a closed circle, if you guys remember from inequalities. Brackets represent greater than or equal to or less than or equal to, as in this A is included in the solution set and this B is included in the solution set. So how we would graph this? So would we have an open circle or a closed circle? If you guys remember these number lines, we would have closed circles because, again, brackets indicate that it is included in the solution set. This A is part of that interval. This B is part of that interval. It is a possible solution, so we need to include it, and we indicate this by using brackets. So let's look at an example. So you have this interval between 2 and 5 because we have brackets. 2 is included and 5 is included. So we're focusing on all the possible numbers between 2 and 5 and also including 2 and 5. So I graphed it on this number line for you guys. It's between 2 and 5, this interval we're looking at. But because 2 and 5 are included, I filled in the circles for you guys. So they are included in that solution set. So this given number x could be 2 or 5 or any of the numbers between them. Hopefully you understand the concept of intervals now. Let's look at more. So this is the exact same. This interval right here is the exact same one as the first one, A, B. But we see parentheses instead of brackets. Parentheses indicate that this A is not included in the solution set and this B is not included in the solution set. The solution set spans all the numbers between them, but it does not include them. This would be like your less than or greater than. Less than or greater than sign, you don't include the actual number that is indicated. So like x is greater than 5. 5 is not actually part of the solution set. So would the circle be open or closed on the number line? They would be open. Look over here at the example, the same thing. Between 2 and 5, but we have parentheses. So if you see, it spans that whole interval between 2 and 5, that whole solution set, but because we have open circles, 2 and 5 are not included in that solution set. Let's look at this third one. The interval A, the same interval A, B, but you have parentheses next to A and a bracket next to B. So would this be open or closed? I want to think of this as a hybrid kind of situation. So it's open on the left as in A. Whichever value A is, we have a open circle on A. We have a closed circle on the right where B is, because B is a bracket, so B is included in the solution set. So we would indicate that with a closed circle. So look at this example 2, 5, the exact same thing. Again, the interval between these two, but there's a parenthesis next to 2, meaning you have an open circle on 2. 2 is not included in the solution set. Then you span that interval between them, and when you get to 5, you put a closed circle, because there's a bracket next to 5, meaning 5 is included in the solution set. Let's look at our second set of examples. So let's say you have this interval right here. It's similar to the last one we did, but you just flip the bracket and the parenthesis. So bracket on A, parenthesis on B. What does this mean, open or closed? You have open on the right because B is not included because of the parenthesis, but closed on left because there's a bracket next to A, and that means it is included, so that's a closed circle. So let's look at the same example right here. Look at this example. So 2, because 2 has a bracket next to it, it's included. So it is filled in, closed circle. Then you span that interval and you have to put another circle on 5, but because 5 is next to a parenthesis, you leave the circle open to indicate that it is not part of the solution set. Let's look at these two. These two are a little bit different. The interval is a closed circle on A because you have a bracket on A, but then you have an infinity sign right next to this. What would this look like? So this would look like something, this would be written as X is greater than A. So think of any number A. So if I said A was 5, this would be X is greater than 5. So X is any value that is greater than 5, spanning on until infinity. It's not a specific interval, but we have to, if we want to do interval notation, that's how we indicate that. So we do a bracket on A because A is included, but because we always do a parenthesis on negative or positive infinity. So if X is greater than 5, it's spanning into positive infinity. So we do positive infinity, open or closed, closed on A, open on infinity. It's indicated right here. So because I have this example right here, there's a closed circle on 2, and because it spans on until infinity, we indicate that with a line. It just goes on and on and on. You don't indicate this with any circle over here. Always remember to use a parenthesis with these infinity signs. And a similar thing that's going on over here is that we have negative infinity leading up to B. This would be like X is less than 5. So you're indicating that it is every value less than 5, spanning all the way into negative infinity. So open or closed? Well, it would be closed on B because B is part of the solution set, but because we have a negative infinity, a type of infinity, we always leave a parenthesis, always open on negative infinity. So if we looked at the example, like I just said, negative infinity and 5, because 5 is included in the solution set, we put a closed circle on 5, and because it's spanning all the way into negative infinity, we draw a line going out like a ray almost, and we draw that going towards negative infinity to indicate that. No circle here, because again, infinity does not require any kind of circle. All right. So let's compare these inequalities that you guys learned in Algebra 1, and we will look at interval notation. These two go hand in hand. Interval notation is a way of showing inequalities and solution sets in higher level math. You need to understand the kind of shorthand that is involved, shorthand being how these are faster to write than these. So that's why they are used in higher level math. It's a harder concept to understand, but hopefully you guys got it through those 6 examples that I showed you. Maybe if we go through some more examples comparing these two, that will help you as well. Let's get into it. So our first inequality example. Can you solve the inequality in graph its solution? So I've given you your basic inequality. 3x minus 12 is less than 3. So let's first tackle solving this so we get x by itself. So what I did first was I added 12 to both sides. 3x is less than 15. Then you want to get x by itself, so you divide by 3. X is less than 5. Then what I did was I took this inequality and I put it into interval notation. I converted it to interval notation. So the greatest value that x can be is 5, right? So 5 would go on the right. It would be almost like your b. So, but is 5 included in this? If this was x is less than or equal to 5, this would be a bracket. But since this is less than, 5 is not included in the solution set, so I put a parenthesis. Then, if you look at this, x is less than 5. Therefore, x can be any value less than 5. So it spans all the way into negative infinity. That's why we wrote negative infinity here. And we put a parenthesis because we always put parenthesis with any kind of infinity. Very simple. If you get this concept, you can graph it easily. Open circle on 5 because 5 is not included. Spanning into negative infinity with a line to indicate that. Okay, let's go to the next one. So this is our second inequalities example. Can you solve the inequality and graph its solution? This is a little bit longer. 6 plus 5 times the quantity 2 minus x is less than or equal to 41. So first you want to use, like last time, you want to solve this inequality, get x by itself. So first let's distribute. 5 times 2 is 10. 5 times negative x is negative 5x. So we get 6 plus 10 minus 5x is less than or equal to 41. Then we can add 6 plus 10, 16. 16 minus 5x is less than or equal to 41. Then we will subtract 16 from both sides. Negative 5x is less than or equal to 25. And then we divide by negative 5. Remember, when you divide by a negative number, this inequality sign will flip. So because it's a less than or equal to now, because we divide by negative 5, it will become a greater than or equal to. So 25 divided by negative 5 is negative 5. We swap the sign. X is greater than or equal to negative 5. And again, we want to convert this to interval notation. So think of it this way. X can be any value greater than negative 5, but it can also be equal to negative 5. So the smallest it can be is negative 5, so that's like our A. But because it can also be negative 5, we put a bracket next to negative 5 to indicate this is part of the solution set. And because it spans on into positive infinity, we indicate positive infinity here. We put a parenthesis because we put parenthesis with infinities. So because we want to indicate negative 5, we put a closed circle on negative 5 on this number line to indicate that's part of the solution set, and then we span on into positive infinity because x can be equal to negative 5, as seen here, but it can also be any value greater than negative 5. Okay, let's get into our last section where we're going to tie everything together. We're going to put interval notation to the test, what we just learned, and if you guys recall from the last video I made, Algebra 1 Review, we're going to also see how it relates to domains, ranges, and functions in general. So you guys will see how you can apply this aside from basic number lines to full-scale functions and graphs. So we'll look at our first example of interval notation and functions. So here's an image of a function I just put up for you guys. It is a cubic function. You guys don't need to know that right now. We will understand those later on, but I'm just telling you, if you're curious, it's a cubic function. So first, if we want to understand, I outlined how to solve this for you guys. So the first question I am asking you, is this a function? So if you guys remember from the last video, the way to test for functions on graphs is to use the vertical line test. So we're going to pretend that a pointer is a vertical, is me drawing a vertical line, and we're just going to run through it, vertical line, vertical line, vertical line, vertical line, vertical line, vertical line. This passes the vertical line test because every vertical line I drew, it only hit the function in one place, meaning that every x value corresponds to a y value, a single y value. This abides by that overall law of functions. So this is a function. Now let's figure out what the domain is. So let's first understand the domain. So the domain is your x values. The domain are your x values. So again, the domain are your x values. So your x values span on this way into positive infinity and this way into negative infinity. Let's follow these lines. These arrows continue on and on and on. If you look at it, it technically will continue on into positive infinity, this right half. So it'll eventually encompass all possible positive x values. This left side also continues on into infinity, if you see. It just continues onward and onward and onward. Continues and encompasses all the negative x values. So this function will eventually cover all given x values. Therefore, it continues negative infinity and positive infinity. The way we would indicate this with interval notation, negative infinity, positive infinity. This is the interval. It covers everything. So we're trying to indicate that it continues on a negative infinity, but it also continues on into positive infinity. Then I'm going to ask you, what is the range? It's the exact same thing. You continue onward and onward, upward and onward and onward, downward. By going downward, you are encompassing all the negative y values. By going upward, you're encompassing all the positive y values. To indicate that this encompasses all possible y values, a y coordinates in it's in the function, you would indicate at negative infinity to positive infinity, because this is the interval. It encompasses everything. So this is how you would kind of understand this graph right here, applying interval notation to this function. Let's look at another example, example number two. So this is a graph of a circle, as you can see. So first we want to determine, like we did with the last one, is this a function or not? So we're going to draw vertical line, a bunch of vertical lines. And if you see, every single vertical line I draw hits the circle in two different places. That means that one x value, for example, the x value 1, it corresponds with the y value of 3 and the y value of negative 3, about, roughly. So this is not a function. This does not count as a function. But we can still find out what the domain and range are. So to find the domain, let's first find the smallest x value, that the x coordinate that is part of the function. And if we continue towards the left, we see it's negative 3. It doesn't go any smaller than negative 3 for the x's. So that would be our smallest x value. That would be the smallest domain value, negative 3. And we do a bracket because negative 3 is included in this function. This x coordinate can be seen when we map out the coordinates of this function. This is included. Now let's continue right to the right to see what the greatest x value is. And that is 3. It doesn't go any larger than 3. So that's why this interval spans from negative 3 to 3. 3 is also included. It is an x coordinate. If I told you the coordinate 0, 3, that is part, 3, 0, flip it around. 3, 0, that is part of the function that is included in this, that is included in this graph. This is not a function again. That is included in this graph. So the interval is negative 3, 2, 3, and you include both of them because they're both part of this circle. How about the range? It's the same thing. The greatest the range will be is 3. The smallest it'll be is negative 3. Those are the y values. That's like what the y values span. So you indicate negative 3, 3, and then you use brackets to indicate that they are part of the function. They're included in, not function. They're included in this graph. Pardon me. I keep saying function, but I want to reiterate that this is not a function. This does not count as a function. So this graph, this is the interval for the y-coordinates, negative 3 to 3, brackets, again, because they are included in the function graph. They're included in the graph. All right, to end this, I would like to give you guys a real-world application, because in my Intro to Algebra 2 video, I promised that I would always wrap things up by giving you real-world applications, by talking to you guys about how you can apply these to your real life. Well, for this one, I want to give you a bit of a historical application, as in where did this concept for interval notation come from? So it came from Isaac Newton and Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. So, pardon me if I'm saying his name wrong. But Isaac Newton, as you guys know, is a physics genius. And Leibniz here is a calculus genius. The reason interval notation was developed was because these two often did many experiments, problem solving, trying to mess around with calculus and physics. But in their notes, they needed shorthand. Shorthand is that they needed to jot things down very, very quickly in order to indicate inequalities. Instead of having to draw whole number lines, they just indicated it with brackets and parentheses. They developed interval notation as part of their shorthand, and that eventually began to represent the whole concept of inequalities, and all those number lines you see, they can all be summed up, even domain and range can be summed up simply with an interval. So that was shorthand, and the reason interval notation, I believe, is a higher level math is because not many people are able to understand intervals. Intervals, to start off with Algebra 2, are a pretty difficult concept. But if you watch this video, hopefully you understand what they are and you guys get a better grasp of how they can also be applied and where they came from, like the historical origin of them. for further reading, on this, here's a link for you guys if you want to see where I found this from. You can always copy and paste this URL and just do further reading on the origin of interval notation. So that's it for today, guys. Thank you for joining me, Anita Raj, on eCoreAcademy for our lesson, Interval Notation, our second lesson for Algebra 2. I'm really excited to kick off this course with you guys because it's one that I think many of you will benefit from, and I want to give you everything I know so that you guys can thrive, so that you guys can feel that you are learning Algebra 2 to the best of your ability, and so that you feel like you're challenging yourself. So then again, please like this video to show your support and love, and also subscribe to the channel for future content, and so that you can see more videos I make for this channel if you guys really like Algebra 2 and the way I teach it. Also, our website link is eCoreAcademy.org. We will be putting up videos, notes, simulations, everything you need to master these topics, even many steps further than our YouTube channel. So please check that out. It will really help many of you avid learners. Then we have our social medias, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Please check that out and show them love to help us develop the eCoreAcademy community. Reach out to us through our Gmail if you guys have suggestions or have questions that need to be answered. And we also have Google Space. So please check all that out. Again, please show us some love. We really enjoy making content for you guys. We really want to keep all the content coming. Please give us suggestions, anything you want, anything you need. eCoreAcademy is tailored to for enrichment students by enrichment students. So thank you for watching this video and have a nice day.